Let's get started here. I started it earlier, and just before I was ready to start, actually, suddenly the computer said, physical memory dump. A problem has been detected with your computer. It crashed just like before. I said, physical memory dump. I said, you know what? Physical memory dump sounds like a pretty neat thing to do. Maybe we can dump our physical memory. Keep in mind that what is this world? It's really, the way it should be put, it's an attempt to kill God, is really what it really is. The ego is trying to attack and kill God. And what is the ego? It's our own arrogance. It's our own arrogance. We're trying to be greater than God. And what are these bodies? The guinea pigs. I mean, basically say, well, we got to figure out how to kill God. Let's use these bodies, you know, and we'll figure out how to attack these bodies and make them sick and make them die. This world is really not that impressive at all, actually. The tour guide for this planet, you know, like you have this, you go to an island, you have, you know, the tour guides say, let us show you how wonderful our island is and bring you here and here. And isn't this wonderful? You get these tour guides. And, you know, this world is not so wonderful at all. More and more you realize it's a terrible place. It's absolutely a terrible place. There's nothing to recommend it at all. So maybe we can dump our physical memory of this place. However, we have something even more important to talk about, which I didn't expect at all. So that's why I did not tape this morning, because something has just happened. Last video I did, I told you about this terrible storm that's coming here. And ideological storm, it's maybe on many levels, and how I took refuge under this big, huge tree, which represents a huge tradition. Oh, it wasn't good enough, and there was this table, some square table, sort of black and white granite. I said, where did this come from? This is, and I took refuge under that, and it saved me. Now, I want to show you something here. Oops. Maybe I should preface that. I was in a gas station several days ago, and I saw somebody walking towards the office of the gas station, and I kind of like said, whoa, maybe I shouldn't look at this. And they said, no, I've got to. It sort of startled me. I said, who is that? And it flashed through my mind that this is something significant. And the way this man looked, I looked at him, I said, oh my gosh, this man looks like Ramana Maharshi. The white beard, the head, everything. I mean, everything was like, whoa. I knew it wasn't, but the similarity was shocking. And I said that Ramana Maharshi was in my dream a couple days ago, talking about this practice that I'm doing, this zeroing out concepts, and saying, go for it. This is the way to do it. And so, lo and behold, today, a situation arose completely out of the blue, where I... how do I put this? I ended up meeting someone from South India and helping them out. Southern India, which is where Ramana Maharshi was from. And then I ended up getting this, being given this. Now, I don't know how this is going to... It's an elephant. It's a drawing of an elephant. Let's see. You see the elephant there, and on top is the, you can't really see it, is the Maharaj. There you go, riding this elephant. There you go. Okay, I was given this. But notice the frame, the square granite frame. I even asked this man, how are the temples built? He said, they're built of granite. He said, they're granite. Well, in the dream, how the temples in India built. In the dream, I had this granite, black and white granite counter top table, and I was able to take refuge under that and protect me from the storm. So suddenly the next day, somebody I don't know, and the circumstances were very convoluted, how somehow I ended up being like a tour guide for this someone from Southern India here. And then he gave me this, and the writing on this is the Maharaj writing on a sumptuous saddle on an elephant. lavishly adorned with jewelry. So the Maharaj is coming. And I was sort of resting today, and suddenly I realized, hey, this is a sign that the Maharaj is coming. Maharaj means great king. For instance, in Sagadatta, Maharaj was called, in Sagadatta Maharaj, someone who was enlightened, great king, Maharaj, someone's trying to call me. So, I suddenly flashed on me, what's going on here? The square of this silk drawing on silk, is exactly the kind of color, the black and white granite, in the exact square that was in the dream that I took refuge under. And of course, within this square is this huge elephant, and the Maharaj riding this huge elephant. Let me see, who tried to call me? Someone tried to call me. My phone's not working properly. Oh well. Technology maybe becomes obsolete after a short time. What's going on here? You see, what is going on here? A series of events, now unexpected events. Sitting in a gas station, suddenly I did a double take. I said, "Holy cow! Is that Ramana Maharshi right there?" And then a dream, and then this situation: the dream of Ramana, then the dream of the storm, taking refuge under this granite table. And then this, being given this silk painting, seeing the Maharaj arriving on this elephant, which is can be a sign of great spiritual wisdom. Maharaj, the great king is coming. Wow. This is a wow that's going on right now. Now, and the pressures, I feel very terrible. I've had a lot of emergencies, 4 nights in a row. There's been all sorts of emergencies. People are struggling right now. The stress is on, whether we know it or not. But what is it that I took refuge under in that terrible storm? Black and white countertop. Black and white. I wonder, black and white, somebody from the black and white era. The pictures are in black and white. Almost all pictures of like Ramana Maharshi are in black and white. Or it could be the philosophy, the teaching that is very cut and dried, very black and white. So these are like attention getters here. I've been thinking about Ramana Maharshi lately. It's on my mind. Maybe a whole bunch of spiritual helpers. I invited everyone back. I said, everyone show, everyone who can. Why not show up and bless us all? And yesterday I got this feeling like, you know, this is what they want. They live for it. It is to bless us. If you're free from this dream of death, and you see your spiritual kin folk here suffering so hideously with spiritual inarticulateness and fear, what do you want to do? You want them to be blessed for sure. So it's not like we should be begging God, oh God, come on, please, you're not one, you gotta bless us. And God very reluctant. I would say it's just the opposite. It's like all those who are liberate have been freed from arrogance and the belief that they can change what they are, be different than what they are. All those have been freed from the dream of death and now realize that they are true eternal life. They've always been. They want nothing better than to bless us. This is what they want to help. They want to help. So why not invite them in and say, yeah, we'll accept your help. We'll accept your blessings. This is what I did. I just said, you know, let's just accept everyone's blessings who can give us blessings. Why not? Why not accept it all? So there's a sort of a deep turnaround here. And of course, when they blessed us, there's a catch-22 saying, why didn't you bless us before? Well, maybe we didn't ask for it. Maybe we were trying to bless ourselves with our intellect or something. And weren't really asking for true blessings. So we're here in this video and we're trying to ramp up our spiritual sophistication, spiritual articulateness, spiritual familiar, you know, we're supposed to be very fluent in spiritual ideas, considerations, techniques, practices. We want to be very, very fluent. So, and we know that the key to success is full stop in the wow, is being able to get information and then realize, wow, that's very shocking. And then to be patient with this and let the shock wear off and not struggle and not try to gloss it over. You know, have the humility to realize, hey, this is really shocking me. It's not like figures and numbers of calculating something and you just keep going right on. People with numbers, they can just, you know, measure, calculate. And they can keep, it seems like progress is continuous for them. But with spiritual path, the progress is not smooth like that. It's punctuated by shock, actually. Quite stunning. So it's a very different discipline. It's not an entrepreneurial business success discipline at all, which is why those who are engaged in that should be this different class, like the Brahmin class. You can't be expected to be competing in the business class, the military class, these different classes, because you have to spend time a lot of time in quietude and contemplation and sitting still, not doing anything, not calculating at all. And we've gone over this, you know, ad infinitum, but we will continue to do so. So I say that Jesus is already back, but that may not be the only one that's back in some way. Maybe Ramana Maharshi is coming back to help out, to bless us. The more the merrier. The more the merrier, absolutely. We want to get this feeling that, you know, the blessings are coming from all angles, just as the troubles are coming from all angles in this world. Why not have the blessings coming from all angles? Why not? Already said Longchenpa has come back. You know. So there may be three already come back. Longchenpa, I was aware, November 2nd, 2014. Jesus, like let's say April 30th to May 1st, that area there, I was aware that he announced that he had come back. And now maybe Ramana Maharshi is announcing that he is back here. We may be getting all sorts of teachers coming back because this is the crucial time in this world. Now, again, this world, what is it? It's not impressive at all. We have to realize it's not impressive. I'm not impressed. I'm not impressed by it at all. This is very important. You know, from one perspective, we look at this world and we just say, how could I ever have been impressed by that? That's ridiculous. I just made this silly little ornament, you know, designed to represent, you know, the belief that I can, you know, change God, that I can die. And, you know, is the world really impressive? No. Because being here, I'm bored. I'm not interested in it. You know, you want to travel somewhere? No, I don't want to travel anywhere. Do you want to go see, you know, some? No. I mean, what are you going to see? Rocks. Sky, rocks. Plant, vegetation, water, you know, so what? Death everywhere, the cycles of nature everywhere, weather. I want to go see weather. Who wants weather? Who wants to be weathered? You know, the sun is just, all the rays are breaking everything down. You put something out in the sun, and you just, you know, eventually disintegrates. Just everything's being zapped and broken down. This world does not impress me in the slightest bit. But we trumpet it as if it's some grand accomplishment. And so we think, well, you're so privileged to be here. No, I'm not. I remember people, before I came here, the spirits saying, oh, help. What they really want help in is to kill God. And so they said, can you lend a body to this help? And if we can, you know, attack your mind and destroy your body, then that will really help us figure out how we can destroy God. You know, they're trying to figure out, you know, how can we destroy God? And we're trying to do it through destroying ourselves. And because we're one with God, we're not separate from God. So if we destroyed ourselves, God would be destroyed also. And so we use these bodies as if they represented us, and then work on them, and then hopefully we think through sympathetic magic, the spirit will be affected by the death of the body. But it isn't. It isn't. Yeah. They tried that on Jesus and said, no. Make a straw man, destroy the straw man. We think that we destroy what it represented. It doesn't at all. So again, spiritual articulateness, taking refuge. Will there be refuge? Maybe from many angles. There's going to be help from many angles. And yet it needs to be somewhat fresh, because I found the tree was not quite enough. The tree of what our experience here, tree of tradition. Yeah, I link that tree to tradition. So tradition is not good enough. You need something fresh, just like A Course in Miracles, very fresh. And those who are stuck in tradition, they just, you know, can't get with it. But it's what tradition really points to, okay? But it tradition itself gets very fuzzy and straggly, and is itself subject to all sorts of modification and change. And so, but what it's pointing to is that which doesn't change. But you really can't get a tradition here which quite has the freshness of that we need, and the coverage that we need, because it is subject to constant modifications and spin doctoring, and the storm gets through, the storm of death, the storm of darkness. So what do you make of this? This is, you know, I had no inkling of any of this coming. And the, if I catch the red light just right, it will. Do I have any inkling of this at all? No. There you go. Now, if you're having a difficult time right now, again, this is not surprising. As I've said before, it's the medical pharmaceutical medical complex, healthcare complex altogether. The entire healthcare complex is what drives our ideology here. And of course, really, we're spirit, and we don't need anything healthcare whatsoever, in truth. And this healthcare comp matrix is trying to destroy, shut out, ruin, get rid of all spiritual truth, so that it can feel secure, that stable and secure, and say this is the way that this is what we need. We need to be able to treat the body with drugs, and sick. We're going to have lots of sickness and illnesses, but we get to treat them. This is the very, very important dividing point. This is coming to light now, more and more. Now, I'm not super articulate on this in this video. I have been in others, because of this other factor that suddenly showed up on the scene here. You know, what if Ramana Maharshi were to show up spiritually very strongly, or you know, some way. You know, this is, of course, he was absolutely not concerned at all about medicine, about treating the body in any way. He said the body is just nothing. It's just a shell, an empty shell, a shadow, is nothing. I don't need to do anything with the body, completely detached from the body. Great example. And in his awareness, he said he's not even, you know, only, you know, faintly even aware of the body, and its importance was nothing except just as a communication device. But and so we have a hard time with this here, but we've been trying to articulate this, and I feel it we can articulate it, we can recognize it, we can get it. There's no doubt about it. We just have to get a little boost. It is within our purview, and we can accept it. It's actually a demand that we place value upon the body by that our arrogance, which wants to kill God. That's what it demands of us. It demands that we identify with the body. It demands that we have a body. It demands we come to a world, have a body, identify with the body, get sick. All of this. These are the demands that are placed upon us in this world, as we, and even getting us into this world. This is what it is. Spirit isn't a body, doesn't have a body, never has, never will. But this is only for the purpose of trying to kill God, plain and simple. So we can give that up. We don't have to do that. We're already here in the world with a body. We don't need to get rid of it, but we certainly don't need to be sick. Now Ramana didn't care at all. I mean, he was even beyond. It made no difference to him what the body was functioning. It was just like a faint shadow on the ground somewhere. Now we're not quite at that point, but we can certainly. The body can be perfectly well and not stressed out, and not even, Jesus says, no, don't feel anything. It it functions perfectly. Now, the ego doesn't want this. Wants us to be struggling, getting sick, because that's evidence that we're allowing the body to be used as a guinea pig to try to attack the mind. But it's really the mind that's attacking itself. The body's really not being attacked. Nothing can happen to the body. It's an image in the mind. So it's a mental projection. So anything that happens to the body is a mental projection. It means the mind still believes that it can attack itself, and it's trying to. Physical memory dump. Interesting. Do we really need a physical memory? Maybe not, right? Maybe this is what will be helped with, physical memory dump. Just start getting used to this, start getting articulate with this. This is how it works. Somehow the Holy Spirit introduces something and we haven't thought of, quite, you know, focused on, and we begin to start focusing in on it and saying, hey, can we do a physical memory dump. I was invited to India. Anytime you come by, we'll stay. You can stay with us, and we'll take care of you, and all this kind of stuff. Kind of invitation to India, just completely out of the blue. And not that I have any interest in going to India or traveling or anything. But you know, I said, well, who knows? Maybe India will come to us. But in an area which is near Tiruvannamalai, near. Ramana Maharshi's Ramana Ashram, near enough to go to it, you know, to travel to it. That would be quite something. But maybe Ramana will travel to us here. Now, what was Ramana? Was the quiet, still quiet, saying everything, doing everything by doing nothing, saying nothing. This enabled us to shift off of physicality. It was greatly helpful to shift off of physicality. Which is what we need. We live in this extraordinarily physical culture. I was in this gym, this fitness center today, again, by someone invited me in by happenstance, complete happenstance. And this is all the rage right now. And fitness boutiques. The ladies used to have clothing boutiques. Now they have fitness boutiques, actually. And this is what this is. And the roll-up door is like super hot. The sun hits it and it radiates extreme heat into the area. It's a big problem. So, causing all sorts of problems. Too much heat. Things are going to heat up in this world. I said, throw some shade across it, block the sun from getting in, the heat. You know, this sun actually represents the ego, actually. It doesn't represent God, it represents the ego. Block the ego from, you know, physical, dump our physical memory. Now, we don't know exactly what this means, but we can talk about it, right? We can say, hey, yes, I've already, yes, I can, yes, I will, yes, I've already done it. This is a three-step phase we can use. Yes, I can dump physical memory. Yes, I will dump physical memory. Yes, I've already dumped physical memory. So we start out, we realize there's these three stages. Yes, I can. Yes, I can dump physical memory. Yes, I can do that. Yes, I will. I will do it. I can. No, I will. I will do it. And then I've already done it. I've done it. I've dumped physical memory. I have already dumped physical memory. I have dumped physical memory. And now, we don't know what that means exactly. That's okay. But we're practicing. So we're asserting. Yes, I can. I can drink. I can dump physical memory. I can. So spiritually, we feel, you know what? I know what it means spiritually. I really do. Now, how to translate that into the word, I'm not sure what kind of words. It doesn't matter right at this point. But I do know what it means spiritually. Just have to trust our spiritual intuition. So I can dump physical memory. I will dump physical memory. I've already dumped physical memory. Song by the Chiffon, sweet talking guy, just that lyric, sweet talking, sweet talking, sweet talking, sweet talking, sweet talking, sweet talking guy. Ramana didn't say anything, but people felt this tremendous sweetness. It was just astonishing because he was saying everything he said. I'm saying the totality, all that can be said, all that can be expressed, it's all here. And there's a tremendous sweetness. So very interesting. I was going last night on a retrospective on the 60s, the girl groups of the 60s, the Chiffons, the Shirelles, you know, the Ronettes. That was all the rage in 63, 64, you know, the Phil Spector and the Wall of Sound, and then the Crystals, right? Boy, was that popular. Of course, the Supremes also, you know, there's a very strong presence in the songs of that time. Still, the songs still sound great. He's a Rebel by the Crystals. Actually, it's by the Blossoms. Darling Love sang lead on that, and the Crystals got the credit. They were on the East Coast, and they couldn't record, so they used the Blossoms. They recorded the song, but the Crystals were credited for the song. No credit was given to the Blossoms at all, and they never got paid anything for it, which is typical of that time. Or at least maybe of Phil Spector. But yeah, pretty much typical. You didn't get paid very well. But and another interesting thing. Walking in the rain. Was that the Ronettes? I've been listening to that, and it goes over my mind, walking in the rain. But what that dream was, terrible thunderstorm, and having to take refuge in it. The rain, the idea is that the rain is, there's some rain is coming. Some Christians call it the latter rain. Of course, they believe it's the Holy Spirit's going to rain down grace on the world. But this thunderstorm that I saw seems to be something other than, you know, grace at this period. There may, you know, grace will certainly help us, but there's this ideological storm. You wonder, where is that? I don't see it. Well, it's happening everywhere. If you have eyes to see it. It's the influence of our ideology, the ego's ideology, that we're a body, that we get sick, that the way to treat sickness is through drugs and through surgery and medical modalities, and that we're spiritually inarticulate. This is all pervasive. It's hitting us. You know, every commercial the pharmaceutical companies put on television, it's like an artillery round. I mean, it's like dropping a bomb on us. It's just each one of those things, boom, 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 is like mortars coming in into our psyche. Mortars into our psyche. It's like a thunder. It's a storm. Each one of these is a big raindrop. Boom, boom, boom. And it hits us. We get wet. It chills us. You know, it chills us. It saps the heat out of us. It saps the energy out of us. It saps our will. It gradually we start turning into a spiritual corpse, as it were. And so this is going on just ferociously. And what I saw is something is coming this way. Soon, really soon. People are realizing, wow, it's almost the end of August here. We're talking about a matter of, you know, 10, 11 days now. And today's the 20th, so yeah, it would be 11 days, and now almost 10. So then we're exiting September, and this is when the, you know, September storm is likely to happen. It could be very well be ideological, which is the worst storm of all, of course. Jesus said, don't fear those who can kill the body, fear those who can, you know, kill the soul, the spirit. But the core spirit can't be killed, but what he meant was who tried to make you feel spiritually inarticulate and you know, I just don't understand, I can't handle this spiritual truth, I have no facility with it whatsoever. This is what you should be concerned about, and this is what's happening in the world. And there could be this all-out blitzkrieg. I expect there will be. So this is why it's important to realize, be articulate about the times, is when help arrives, you have to realize, okay, we understand why the help is here. Okay, let's take it in the right context. There's this terrible storm that is coming, and we need refuge from it. And then we don't mess around. We say, no, it's an absolute slam dunk here, but this is what we're going to do. So in the dream, I just got under this table and just huddled up there and just stayed there and didn't move and just waited the storm out. I didn't do anything. So maybe there'll be some place, some situation where we can go and we can just, you know, sit there quietly and be protected from this storm, this ideological storm, where we're going to be, they're going to try to convince, to wipe out our spiritual articulateness. And tried to convince us that forevermore that we're just bodies. We're not free. That this is our home. This is where, you know, what made us, and all this kind of nonsense. The storm is there. I saw it in the sky. Wow, It was off to my left, the left side, my left side. And it came in real fast. Which I expect. I expect that there's a revival taking place right now, actually. Astonishing revival. That, you know, a month ago, who could have thought of such a thing? And like I said, June 22nd, 2015, after this, look out. We're not going to believe what happens, hardly. It's just going to be extraordinary turmoil and change. And look at in the United States. I know there are a lot of viewers from other countries. This Donald Trump phenomenon, it came out of nowhere. I mean, I was not ever even considering, no idea. And he suddenly one day he shows up on a stage and says, "Hey, guess what, folks? I'm running for president, and this is what I'm going to do." And from that very moment, it's just been just like, you can't believe the upheaval that has taken place. Someone just arrives on the stage and just, you know, in 10 minutes' time, is suddenly lit the fuse. He just lit this fuse. And it's just almost pandemonium. There's a little bug crawling on my face. There's literally this ferment and fervor and pandemonium that is just growing every single day. I've never seen the media so dominated by one person. And people are losing their minds. It's, you know, it's just they're in shock and pandemonium, and there's going to be a pushback against this for sure. September surprise. So this storm is going to hit. We're going to be hit by the storm, and wow, the agitation, the upheaval within us, and this. What the problem about all this is it knocks out our spiritual articulateness as we get emotional, as we get really emotional. Or we take refuge in numbers, in measurement in numbers, or we get all emotional and hysterical and emotional and agitated and angry and all this kind of, you know, uncivil and an uproar. It's an uproar. It's an uproar. And this is what's going to happen. So the counter to that is just peace, absolute peace, quiet, still peace. This is what we really need. So in that dream, I just was hunched under this table and just sat, didn't move. Just waited. I said, "I hope the rain doesn't hit me," and it didn't. It didn't. I stayed dry. Stayed dry. And that's another way of saying you don't get sucked into the emotions. Emotions tend to cloud reason very badly. And I did see someone walking around in the rain with this waterproof jacket and they weren't getting wet. But I said, "Wow, ha!" You know, I said, "I left that at home." I don't have that. You know, I left it at home when I came to this desert here. And I said, "God, why, if I had one of those, it would be no problem." But this must mean, you know, the impervious to the rain, completely waterproof, that you can't be touched by delusion at all. So I did see some that actually were walking around helping out with this. They had waterproof suits on. You could say that those might be, you know, the ones who have been liberated from arrogance. So really, if we knew it in hindsight, if this moment, we really had hindsight on this moment, we could say that we're right on the brink here. And what's been happening to me, these various signs are quite extraordinary. I don't know how else you could possibly say about it. The Maharaj arriving on an elephant. The Maharaj arriving on an elephant. Elephant, great power, great wisdom, great stability, great strength. You see, this is a very, very potent sign. Just to be given this, like this. Free. Someone says, hey, don't, hey, wait, stay right there, don't leave. Came back, here, this is for you. It's like, wow. It's like, it's really important to give that to me. Ramana is working in mysterious ways, huh? Now, here's the thing. In our present condition, it's difficult to focus in as well as we'd like to, and we feel inept. All right, to a certain extent, inept. There's no question about it. We've been bombarded, and by inarticulateness, spiritual inarticulateness, to such an extent, we feel, wow, you know, even if we got some help, you know, are we really worthy? You know, are we going to botch it? You know, all this kind of stuff. So, this is an issue, and this is what I've been working on, and I feel. It's, remember, when the wow hits, this is so important. When the wow hits, you're going to feel shocked and temporarily inarticulate. And you have to identify it as not because you are spiritually inarticulate, is because you've actually made a great leap forward and you're momentarily shocked. And you have to take it that way. The glass is half full. This is absolutely key. The glass is half full. So let's say Ramana Maharshi was here right this moment. Well, I would be pretty much inarticulate right now. My reactions are, you know, kind of dulled right now, and I'd be in the shock of the wow. But I'd say, hey, okay. I'd say, you know, I'm in the shock of the wow right now, so let's just give it some time here to settle in. That's all. And just have faith and confidence, you know, in your articulateness and preparation. And don't say, gee, Ron, I just don't feel I'm really getting it, you know, so maybe you need to come back later because I'm not ready. No, that's the wrong reaction. That's glasses half empty reaction. That's what the world wants us to say. That's what the pharmaceutical culture wants us to say. Cosmic corporate culture, pharmaceutical culture, PC culture. There's one uproar after another in the United States. The anchor baby thing is the latest. I've not been really following that. I'm dealing with something more important, but I have heard that this is just causing an absolute uproar and consternation. Like, you can't use that term or something, you know. Everybody, people say, we're offended, you know. So it's just uproar, you know, that things are not going according to Hoyle, at least on the left. The leftists are saying they think they have everything going their way, and suddenly it's not going their way so much. Well, don't think that they won't bite back. They're notorious for that. And this, I mean, it could be a food fight, folks. I'm telling you. It could be a flat-out food fight. That would be, you know, which is, of course, you know, that's a good way to describe it. plates of spaghetti flying, baguettes being used and hitting people with baguettes, and wine being thrown in the eyes, and and chocolate mousse being stuffed in your face, and you know, just absolutely, food is absolutely flying. People are spraying ketchup and mustard everywhere. This is what we're headed for. I mean, it's the potential is here, and you know, there's crises all over the world. But people all over the world are watching the United States right now. And it is headed towards a food fight. And we don't want to get caught up in that. This will dull the edge of our spiritual articulateness very badly. And so what I did was I prayed and I asked all spiritual teachers to help us right now. You know, all those who have the capacity to help us. I say, come on down, you know. It's like we're in a cafeteria and there's a massive food fight going on, and we want to just say, get over in some little area. Can we get under the table? You know, we're hiding under the table. So sometimes you see in the bar fights, another way of putting it, there's this massive bar fight is ready to break out here. No question about it. And you see in the movies that there's a few people who don't really want to be involved, and they find some table, little table, and they're like underneath the table, and bodies are flying and all over the place, but they're, you know, safe under this table. this is kind of like what's going to happen. We need to find our little table to get under it. So this bar fight, this food fight, which is about to happen. It's about to happen. You've got the players are starting to show up on the stage, the Black Lives Matter people, taking over campaign events, just storming stages. They're storming stages and taking over the microphone and using the captive audience that came there for the candidate to then try to indoctrinate them in their ideology. And that's getting very messy. We have the potential for an absolute out of control food fight. Now, what we need an option. We need an option. We need an option. We need some other option that's more compelling than the food fight. And say, hey, let's do this. Now, we're lukewarm. We seem lukewarm, but keep in mind, it's the shock of the wow when we see our options. We're like, and then we find out, hey, it really is going to happen for us. Wow. And this is what I want to convey. Act as if it really is going to happen for us. We really are going to be protected. We really are going to find refuge. And let this shock or this wow, it's really going to happen. I mean, what's happening with me right now, this is quite shocking, what just happened today. This was not something that I foresaw. It came out of the blue, absolutely out of the blue. And I was like, oh my gosh, I'm meeting someone from South India. What is this? This is really starting to get, the plot is thickening here, isn't it? But I went ahead, I did it. I said, okay. I said, hey, I hope you don't mind riding in a dirty vehicle and everything. He said, no, it's all fine. No problem at all, you know. Yeah, so I just relaxed and went with it, was not nervous. And so what can I do? I'm secure in my spiritual practice of full stop on the wow. And so whatever happens, I always have that with me. So I can always, you know, go, that's a fallback. I can always fall back on this full stop in the wow practice. So here suddenly I'm showing someone from South India around, you know, and helping them out. And they were so grateful and so happy. They said, wow, you made it all happen. I said, it did. It was miraculous. What happened was absolutely miraculous. It's astonishing how well it worked out, actually. I just happened to be at the right place at the right time. People directed me. We just kept running into the right people who gave us all the information, and it just worked out fabulously, absolutely fabulously, without even trying. So that's pretty interesting. So this is bringing up a wow. Bringing up a wow. So I'm just sort of spreading the wow. Let's spread the wow. Hey, you know what? Let's say we really are going to get the help. We really are going to get the help. Now, I know I've been saying this for a long time because I feel that we need to prepare for this, that because it may be quite shocking, and we need to recognize that the wow factor and not think that means we're failing, that we're not worthy. See, the wow doesn't mean that we're not worthy. It actually means we are worthy, that we're recognizing, oh my gosh, we really are worthy. I didn't realize we were. See, we think that we're these bodies born into a world to die. And so we keep trying to generate some worthiness, but it never seems to be enough. The truth is we're not. We're eternal life. We're perfect sons of God, absolutely eternal life. And that's why we're worthy. And so this great boost shows up is because of what we truly are. They know what we are. They know we're perfect. They know we're eternal life. We just are believing that we're pretending to be dead or trying to die. So we don't think we are. So we say, oh, we're not worthy. So you feel this wow. You think, oh, that means unworthiness. No, it doesn't. It means worthiness. The wow means worthiness. The wow means worthiness. This is the glass is half full, meaning I'm worthy. If you say it's half empty, you think, no, I'm just a body, a human, a person here, and what did I do to merit this and this kind of stuff? This is the reaction to all of us here. We're all witches here, trying to. The whole world's a witch. The world is a witch, actually. Tell you the truth, and the witches are always trying to find clever means to poison, to make you sick, to get the body to die. Always scheming. Let me try this. The clever experimenters. And this is what I experience in this world is witchery. Absolutely, from day one, this world is not this world. The world is a witch. At least that's the purpose we've given to it. We can free the world from the purpose that we gave to it. Liberate it. Let it go. And then the world will be absolutely beautiful and help us in every possible way, actually. That's what Jesus says. No reason to disagree with that. So when we believe we're this body, subject to all this death and misery and suffering and stress now, the glass is half empty. We think, for instance, like the Christians, Jesus, and they say, what do we do to merit you coming here, Jesus? I mean, it's always like we're just these human souls, these bodies, and we could never merit this. It's impossible to merit this, so this is the whole thing. No, we're not bodies. No, we're not humans. No, we're not persons. No, we're not personalities. We're absolute, totally, spotlessly, immaculately perfect spiritual being in absolute freedom and all power and all glory. This is what we are. So of course we merit Jesus coming here. We don't have to do anything to merit. We don't have to explain it to Jesus. He knows why that we merit it perfectly. We don't have to say, oh my gosh, Jesus, what do I need to do to, make you think that maybe I could possibly merit this? No, that's just our pretense. Of course we merit it. So this is, the wow is like, it helps us just stop. Say, wait, I don't do anything. Just sit here. Don't do anything. We absolutely deserve this. We absolutely merit. And the liberated ones, the enlightened ones, they know we merit it. And so they want to help us, but they don't force anything. They're completely gentle and non-forceful. Reality doesn't need to force anything, does it? It's already perfect. So they don't force anything, but we can ask them, say, we accept your help. We're absolutely accepting your help. Yes, we can. Yes, we will. Yes, we already have accepted your help and your blessings upon us, which is just a reminder. Blessings is really just a reminder of what we are. That's all that they're doing. They simply remind us, this is what you really are. Unchanging, untouchable, perfect, steady, peaceful, blissful, loving, free, glorious being. Sat, Chit, Ananda, consciousness, what bliss and being, a consciousness, being, awareness, I don't know, see, Sat, cheat. Ananda's bliss, you know. So anyway, this is a, you know what I'm talking about. Glasses half full. We do deserve this, 100%. So they're looking for those who are able to go glasses half full. Yes, we do deserve this, inherently deserve. There's nothing we need to do to deserve this at all, this blessing. And to realize that this is what they want to do. They're just, you know, absolutely so joyful to bless us and to help us. What else would they want to do? You know, if you have a sibling who's like holding their breath and pretending to be dead, you know, and you can't communicate with them, they're on the floor, they're all blue, and they're just, you know, they're pretending, but they don't know they're pretending. They think they're dead. Don't you want more than anything for them to stop pretending? And you do anything to remind them, hey, it's just a pretense. It's just a pretense. That's all. So of course we would. Of course they haven't forsaken us. Of course they're not looking down on us. They know what we really are. See, because they know what they are, truly. And they know we are exactly the same. So they know we're actually complete, absolutely equal with them. And there's no doubt in their mind about that. So of course they're going to remind us of this. And here we feel, you know, this wow, we need to interpret it properly. It means we're worthy. The wow means we're worthy. It doesn't mean that we're unworthy. It means that we're worthy. That's a fact. I wonder if my phone is working or is it off? It's working. Yeah. The wow means we're worthy. So, the wow means we're worthy. They're not looking for businessmen here, business people who are, you know, industrious. They're looking for those who can sit still and quiet and absorb the shock of remembrance. Now, there were others that went under this table. I was aware there was a gathering. I don't know how many. I just was aware there's others. As the storm went on, they said, oh my gosh, there's some way to take refuge, and they were also taking refuge under this table where I was. So it's impossible to ignore the symbology. I mean, just the frame of this, the black and white granite, and the way this person stressed granite. Yeah, oh yeah, all the temples in India made of granite. They're made of granite. Mortar, yeah, limestone, some sort of lime mortar made out of lime. They've lasted for so long. He said so long, 1,500 years or so. That they don't erode somehow. And so this water hitting this granite countertop, tabletop, it did not erode. It was impervious to it. Granite is supposed to be very adamant. It's a symbol for very something like that, which is very adamant. And black and white means, you know, no compromise. It's cut and dried. Truth is true, nothing else is true. I mean, it's a very adamant belief system, and which the rain, the storm cannot penetrate this. So really, ultimately, you know, the greatest practice is what we've been doing, is just sitting quietly. Sit quietly, sit still. Keep your mind on the wow, and realize there's this intensity of continuity shock here. Don't struggle with it, just be patient. Now, to the business mind, this is an anathema, isn't it? So what are you doing? What are you doing? What are you doing? What are you measuring? What are you building? What are you calculating? Is it, yeah, right? But we know this is liberation from our attempt to kill ourselves. Thereby, through extension, kill God, actually. The attack upon ourselves is really trying to attack God. That's why we're attacking ourselves. Trying to attack ourselves, and making a straw man called the body, and then attacking that, but even the straw man is just a mental projection. Now, if we just felt that if sitting quietly like this and in the wow, shock of the wow, if that is sufficient, then maybe we could do this, right? I mean, let's say Ramana Maharshi was here and he says, yeah, you know, you can come here where I am and just sit. It's enough to just come there and sit. We might think like, oh, you know, no, that's just the beginning. Then there's all these mental thing, you know, other stuff. It may be just sufficient to just come and sit. That's what people did when he's here. They just came and sat quietly. Now, subtly, all sorts of subtle help was being given, but the discipline was to sit quietly. So if we can sit quietly, that is sufficient. See, that is sufficient. We don't need to pepper someone with questions. It's all so simple. What questions can we really ask, actually? We don't need to be peppered with answers. Just sit quietly in shock, in spiritual shock, which is a positive, and recognize it as such. So look to the question, can we be helped? Absolutely, we can be helped. We can. And prove it to yourself. And as you get better and do it, you say, hey, I can do this. And then you start proving it to yourself. And then you start to, you know, you start to relax, like, wow, I can do this. I can actually do this. Remember, we're worthy. So what do we need to ask a question? So questions are just designed to say, are we worthy? Are we really, really? Are you? I mean, how do I know I'm worthy? We're worthy, so why do we need to ask questions about it? It's a given. We just need to let the shock dissipate. Because, of course, if you come across a great teacher, you're gonna ask, am I worthy? Am I worthy? Everyone's worthy. It's the question is, do you have the discipline? Do you have the preparation? Can you absorb the shock of it? That's the only question there is, really. It's interesting. We were going to go to Home Depot. This someone wanted to go to Home Depot. And I said, you're not going to find what you're looking for at Home Depot. No way. We ended up going someplace else. We found everything he wanted. Everything. It was unbelievable. It was amazing. But, you know, we don't need to be, we don't want to be lost and wandering around Home Depot, do we? And I actually found something I needed that you can't find at Home Depot. The stuff there is largely junk, to tell you the truth. And we didn't get junk. We got the highest quality stuff. So somehow the grace of God is working, and we do know that there's a food fight pretty much already started. You know how it starts in the cafeteria, a couple of rambunctious kids, you know, like start flinging, you know, pieces of food, some pieces of corn, or you know, throwing a little bit, then they throw back, you know, a little bit, and the kind of, hey boys, you know, settle down over there, you know, and someone else like gets into it and starts throwing, and you know, so before you know it, you know, it can easily erupt into an all-out food fight, where everybody just takes their whatever's on their plate and just starts throwing it, and of course, then you pick up stuff off the floor and you throw it at somebody else, and so we're in this time now where, the food is starting to fly. It's like, wow. This Trump character is, I watched a video clip on him last night, and it was pretty amazing. He is a great comedian, a great actor, a great entertainer. I mean, I haven't seen anyone like this. He is so comfortable in his role, in front of a microphone, in front of a hostile crowd, or you know, whatever, a crowd. And I mean, just the way that he throws out. I mean, he's a master comedian, a master showman. I mean, it's just amazing, actually. It's caught everyone by surprise. He's actually extraordinarily adept at what he does. He could be, an agitator. comedian, yes, absolutely. The timing, the expressions, the hand language, the body language. And he doesn't let anything, like a great comedian doesn't let anything rattle him. Like the crowd, nothing can rattle him, right? He's like that. He keeps delivering these lines, this, and oh, somebody's yelling, heckling me. Boy, he knows how to put down the hecklers. Wham, just squashes them like that. And this is a potent, potent social force right now. Trump has the capability. I mean, people are underestimating his absolute ease in his role that he's doing. He's a polished expert at whatever it is that he's doing. He's doing something, and he's an absolute expert at it. Quite funny. I mean, he's an absolute comedian if you look at it from one standpoint. Hilarious. He's like doing stand-up comedy. He's like a stand-up comic, actually. But he's doing it on the huge stage. And he says, oh, you know, you got this big thing. And he just, you know, like, just, well, we're going to change it. You know, that's finished. You know, you're finished. And like, what? You know, you can't do that. I said, well, that's already done. You know, and moving, you know, now we're going to do this and this. And what? I think a lot of people are finding the humor and laughing at it. I've heard some that just, you know, just say, this is absolutely hilarious. This stand-up act is absolutely hilarious. and, you know, he says, okay, we're done here. I'm done, you know. doesn't even have to answer questions. So they ask a question. No, I'm not interested in that question. And Boris says, hey, you know, this is a question. You got to answer it. He goes, nah, that's not really an important question. Let's ask another question here. Yeah. you just don't do that. This is like comedically funny, actually. Farcically funny. Yeah, of course, he acts just like water for duck's back. What? There's nothing wrong. What's going on here, folks? What are you so riled up about? I don't, you know, it's amazing. He's like, he's doing this shtick like, what don't you guys get? Why are you so upset at me? Well, it's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. So isn't it ridiculous? Of course it's ridiculous. You know? It's okay. We're not going to do that anymore. Everybody loves me. You can love me. You're going to love me. You know, it's great. It's great. Astonishing. Wonderful. Super. And what? You know, nobody talks like this. So I just find it uproariously funny. But food fights can be funny. But again, you lose the spiritual, you can lose your spiritual centeredness here. Very much so. It's shaping up to be an absolute mayhem in the United States in terms of what's going to go on. You know, like a civil war sort of thing. I mean, it just, I don't know, but more, it's absolutely bonkers, this storm that's coming. Because do you think, I mean, they've been trying to crush him like a cockroach, you know. And they, you know, they can't kill the cockroach. So more and more people are saying, hey, wait a minute, we can do this too. Hey, wait a minute, you know, we don't have to be crushed. Hey, wait a minute. And so suddenly, you know, there's this whole shift in attitude. And so this is polarizing a conflict, you know, for sure. Because you've got two confident sides that, you know, each one believes that they can prevail, and you have leaders that feel like, hey, I'm unassailable, you know, I'm uncrushable. This is what happens in history, is you get the rise of these, what do you call it, demiurges, almost like, you can say the Gnostics would call it, some kind of wunder, what do you call it, not a wunderkind, but the hero arrives on the scene, you know, the downtrodden people. Suddenly there's this hero, and the hero just is like not bothered by anything that all the crushing techniques are using on people. They say, well, it's nothing. Yeah, what, that's supposed to bother me? Are you kidding me? It doesn't bother me at all. You're bothered by me. I'm not bothered by you. And it's like people say, wow. So this happens throughout history. It is these actors and actresses arrive upon the stage, and poof, suddenly, you know, history has suddenly changed. I mean, Trump has changed history already, actually. Fundamentally changed history simply by the tone and the attitude, and says, you know, you're playing by my rules. I'm not playing by your rules. You're playing by my rules. We have this huge situation in the world. New World Order says, everybody has to play by our rules, right? Got it? Everyone says, oh boy, I hate this, but yeah, okay, we have to do it. And here comes Trump and says, no, you know, guess what? You're playing by my rules. I'm not playing by those rules at all. And they say, no, you got to play by the rules. He says, no, I don't. You got to play by my rules. And this is just like a fundamental food fight situation. So what do food fights get started by? A couple of strong people, right, in the cafeteria. Really, it's like you have factions, right? And you have like one faction is dominated by this strong person or whatever personality. And then someone else comes in, the new kid on the block, says, hey, everybody, I'm here. I just transferred in from another high school, you know. And hey, everybody, how you doing? How you doing? Hey, nice to see you. I'm a fabulous guy. You're going to love me. You're going to love having me here. I'm a great guy. I'm going to make your high school really great. It's going to be better, way better. In fact, this high school is not so good. It's good. I don't like the way it's being run. You know, I can run it better than this. And then the entrenched power block in the high school, you know, says, who the heck is this guy? Who does he think he is? You know, and then they're going to start testing them. You start like, hey, you know, like someone like across the room is just like, throw some food at him, you know, some spaghetti or whatever. Spaghetti sauce hits him, you know, face, and he turns and says, "Oh, really? Really? You think you can do that to me? Well, here, take this plate of spaghetti in your face, in your face." And then the two strong people factions, you know, food fight starts. Absolutely, it does. And you get the Black Lives Matter, you talk about instigating a food fight. Holy cow. You know. It's like the Black Panthers back in the day, except they're more organized and funded, etc. It's all being funded. And so here we go. Here we go. But ultimately, it's better to sit the food fight out. This is what we're trying to do. We recognize, okay, you know, here we go. What resources do we have? And I've been saying for so long, we need some help. We need some help because it's, you know, otherwise we're going to get caught up in this. And we'll lose track of what the goal really is. The goal is not really anything political or social or anything like that. The goal is to stop pretending that we're dead. You know, that's the goal. You know, absolutely. Ramana said, this body's like just a shell. It's just a seashell. It's just a useless nothing. It's not me. It has nothing to do with what I am. I'm eternal life. You know, I can never die. I can never be born, never die. So what is the body? Nothing. Nothing at all. So when the body dies, you know, bury it, cremate it, whatever, it has nothing to do with me whatsoever. Just like we walk along a beach and see some seashells, you know, and just like, yeah, it's a seashell, you know, it's no big deal. So we need to remember that we're only pretending all this. And this planet is no big deal. Okay, you got to realize this planet is no big deal. We came here because we've got all this hype, like, oh, wow, planet Earth, you man, it's just a really great place. You got to visit this. And the tour directors, you know, are all saying, don't you like this? Isn't this wonderful? How about, isn't this beautiful? Oh, my gosh, you know. And that's, you know, we say, no, you know, actually, it's like terrible, really. I mean, compared to where I came from, I mean, what was I supposed to be impressed by this? I'm sorry, I'm not impressed by it at all. But we have to keep this attitude. I'm not impressed by this world. It's not an impressive place. I mean, what arrogance to think that this world could impress us, you know. What absolute arrogance to think that. We come from perfect glory, infinite glory, and we're supposed to be impressed by this world, like, oh my gosh, how could I ever miss this world? This is so astonishing, it's so extraordinary. No, it's so extraordinarily weird and terrible, actually. But it's not impressive. So we have to keep this mood, attitude of, this world is not impressive at all. I'm not impressed. I'm not even interested in going anywhere in this world anymore at all. You know, Hawaii, should go to Hawaii, you know, no, what, you know, I'm really going to be impressed, oh, there's Diamond Head, there's Waikiki, whatever, well, yeah, so what, it's still same old, same old, same old, you know, there's the heat, there's the rain, there's a rainbow, you know, there's this, oh, okay, well, I'm supposed to be impressed by that? No, come on. Who's trying to kid who here? This physical world, this world like this, I'm supposed to be impressed? No. So more and more and more, if we can get this attitude that this world is not impressive at all, doesn't impress me, never will, never will impress me. So why should I care so much about it? Why should I be trying to remember it, try to keep it, you know, this physical memory of it and stuff? I don't need that. I don't need that. I don't need any physical memory anymore of this world. Drop it. Drop the physical memory. Dump the physical memory. So we're going over and over this. Why spiritual articulateness? You keep practicing. Just like when you're young, you're learning a language, you practice, and you become better and better and better and better and better at whatever you practice. So we're just going over and over and over and over and over this, practice. So it's just like, oh yeah, I'm very articulate, there's no problem, I can speak this like this, I can relate in this way, I can relate to the notion that, hey, I'm not impressed by this world, I shouldn't be impressed by this world, what a ridiculous thing to be impressed by this world in any way. It's dump the physical memory of this world. because we're going to release the world from the purpose that we gave it, which, you know, physical memory is part of the purpose that we gave it. We're going to release the world from that, so we don't need any physical memory of this world, actually. We don't need any physical memory of this world. How about that? This is an tremendous idea. We don't need any physical memory of this world at all. And therefore, when we dump that, we'll just have spiritual presence here. Ramana was just sitting quietly wherever he was. He was just sitting quietly like a stone statue. And the kids would come up and throw food at him, throw like a food fight, throw rocks at him, throw snakes in where he was sitting, torment him, whatever. Mean, cruel kids, you know, saying, let's see if we can disturb him. He was oblivious to it. Completely oblivious. His consciousness was not even aware of his body at all, you know, when he was a lot of times just sitting. So rocks would hit his body, he wouldn't even move. Of course, the kids were interested, you know, it was a phenomenon for them, so you have to understand that, like, they're quite stunned by it. This is, what is this, they're saying. We've never met anything like this at all. How do we get a reaction out of this someone? So they're very nervous about it. You know, so they see, maybe we'll throw some poisonous snakes in by him and get a reaction there, but he didn't even move. But others took care of him and said, wow, you know, he's in this dark, cold, dank place or whatever, and let's get him to a better place here. And they helped him out, moved him around, but he still, it didn't make any difference to him. Well, this is a, you know, like I say, we're not held to that standard quite yet, but we can go towards it. We absolutely can. Dump the physical memory. Dump the physical memory of this world. What an idea that is. What a wonderful focus that is. Dump the memory of this world, physical memory of this world. This is what the ego doesn't want you to do. It wants you to keep the physical memory of this world so you can believe that you're vulnerable, inarticulately vulnerable, helpless, hopeless, helpless, vulnerable, frightened. Repetition, repetition, repetition. Just like practicing a musical instrument here. Anyone who's a musician knows it doesn't happen by itself so much, does it? You have to practice. It's a maddening thing, musical instrument. It's a great discipline because you can't bully it. People you can bully. A musical instrument just sits there. You can't bully it. You say, hey, you know, sound better. It won't. You say, well, I told you to sound better and you're not sounding better. What is this? Play the song for me. It won't play. You have to do it. Like, oh gosh, how am I going to do it? And then, so it's like that. So I have a lot of history of practicing musical instruments. Previous life, piano. This life, guitar. Piano and then guitar. To an extreme extent, and then from that spiritual practicing, and just keep this discipline that, hey, you have to do it. You have to build in familiarity and knowing, like on a musical instrument, when you practice, you do make progress. But if you put in a lot of practice, there's a backlash kind of where you dip down, and it's frustrating. So you go back and you start again. And say, oh, I didn't sound nearly as good as yesterday. What's going on? But if you keep doing it, suddenly you'll suddenly make these shifts where you suddenly now sound way better than you did like a week ago or a month ago. But from day to day to day, there's ups and downs, ups and downs, ups and downs. And this is the same thing with spiritual practice. It's very similar to being a musician, musical practice, actually. Musicians should actually make very good spiritual should be very successful on the spiritual path, because they understand this dynamic. You make a great progress, and then there's this wow, like, wow, I'm kind of shocked. I really am getting it. And for some reason, then there's this dip, and you're not as nearly as quite as sharp as before. Same thing here. The wow shocks us. And I'm feeling like now, like I'm kind of fumbling around. But I just have faith, you know what? I'll just keep doing this, and then who knows, tomorrow, the next day, there will come a time where suddenly I'll just suddenly feel tremendously competent. This same thing with a musical instrument, same thing. And then another shock comes, because suddenly you're way more competent than you used to be, and then that shocks you back into being a little less competent. You know, it's like, wow, I don't know if I'm ready to be so competent. This is the issue, isn't it? I mean, just think about what comes with being super competent on a musical instrument. Well, people want to listen to you play, get up on stage, you know, and oh, we want to hear you, and it goes on and on and on and on and on. So you might be saying, hey, I don't want to be so competent here. Come on, this is kind of scary. There's a lot that comes with that. It was the same thing here. You know, who wants to be the focus of people? You know, and everyone has a sob story. You know, everyone's life is a sob story. We're all trying to die. We're all pretending to be dead. We're all trying to find a way to kill God. And so we're subject to all this witchery, which is constantly going on, actually. It's very clever. I'm aware of it, but pushing back against it is so difficult. People are so adamant about it. The witchery is very clever, actually. It's going on constantly. I know the PC crowd doesn't like the term witchery, but it's a very good term to use. It's very apropos, actually, for the times. And everyone engages. It's not just related to any, but gender. There's just this whole, but the idea of very sneaky, clever, subtle, snaky types of, you know, manipulating situations, getting leverage, so you feel you can't say no to it, and then make, leading you into stuff that subtly is ruinous and harmful to you, and you react to it, and constantly like this. This is the world. This is the world. So witchy, witchy world. You know, it's always been going on. I mean, in the past, the witches would say, you know, God bless your little heart, you know, God bless your heart, and all the sweet, you know, stuff, you know. So, but meanwhile, they're, you know, stabbing you in the back. Now, they just say, freaky, the heck with that, well, you know, we'll just be backstabbers just directly. And then let's not even worry about the niceties of it here and try to, so it's the same. It's the same. It's always been going on. And this is what the spirit is interested in here. They're trying to figure out, how do we kill God? This is the purpose that this world, we gave this world, we made this world for this purpose. How, it's a workshop, it's a laboratory. How do we kill God? We're trying to figure out, how do we kill God? It's that simple. And so we're feverishly working on this. You know, we've been working on it for so long. How can God be killed? We think we have to figure this out. It's, you know, otherwise we can never feel fulfilled or something. And it's not true. We can just set aside this purpose and say, no, God can't be killed, so why are we trying to figure out what can never happen? It's ridiculous. So the Holy Spirit has given us accurate information about the times that we live in. Warning, 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 prepare, prepare, prepare. See, once the food fight breaks out and it's out of control, you know, you know, how do you restore order? Like, you know, wow, it has to run its course, doesn't it? or the factions decide this is it, it's now or never, you know, we're one of us is going to end up dominating, and so they're not going to stop. This is what's going to happen. This is what we're heading towards. These two factions, the factionism in the world, is about ready to collide. And you know, it's just like, you know, when hot moist air hits real cold air, wham, those two factions hit, what happens? Rain, thunderstorm. You might say Trump is the warm, moist air, and the left is the real frigid, cold air, trying to freeze us all. We're trying to turn us into frozen, inarticulate beings here. And here comes this warm, hot air, you know, full of moisture, and we could feel it. And the two collide. What happens? Tremendous rain, tremendous storm. And this is what's happening. The storm is going to happen. You have these factions. Okay, we're getting it clearer now. Trump is like this tropical air mass. It's just sort of suddenly come in like, whoa. You know, wow, you can feel it. Completely different atmosphere, right? Very expansive. Friendly, not all frozen. He's not frozen. This is opposite. Just look at his body language and the way he uses his hands and everything. You know, he's not frozen up. He's not. He's expansive like a hot tropical air mass and relaxed about what he's doing. And this is great. I love it. You know, it's wonderful. We're going to make everything great again. Everything's going to be expansive tropical air mass with full of moisture, full of this feeling of moisture to it. You know, it's wow. And then there's this very, very cold, frigid air mass to the left. It just wants to absolutely turn everyone to stone who they want to. You know, turn us all into stoners. Get completely stoned. Turn into Medusa. You know, the left is like Medusa. Interestingly enough, if I can throw this in here, there's this news article on the mortician in chief playing golf with the Bay Area's favorite son, Steph Curry, back on Martha's Vineyard, his vacation, and Steph reported back, wow. He says, the president absolutely can trash talk with the very best of them. And he said he was just trying to freeze me out. He'd just stare at me, like trying to turn me into a stone. When I was trying to make a 4-foot putt, he'd just be staring at me like that. He said he put intense pressure on me. Of course, Steph did the gracious thing, as he always does, and triple bogey the last hole to give the victory to the mortician in chief. He didn't have to, but of course, under those kind of pressure, you're going to let the chief win. Okay, this is what you do. You put up a good fight, and then you triple bogey the last hole. Good form, Steph. You know. But he gave us, he said, wow, this guy is an expert trash talker, and he'll freeze you out. He tries to freeze you out. This is quite extraordinary. Just like I said in a video yesterday, that you can't pay cash for your medical tests anymore. That's extraordinary. Well, this report from your character is revealed on the golf course, and Steph Curry just revealed that this is what his character is really like. Wow, he said this guy's a killer. I mean, he just stares you down, doesn't say a word, just stares you down. Puts intense pressure on you to freeze you out. It's gamesmanship. It's supposed to cause you to tighten up and freeze up so you can't make the putt. Whereas like someone like Trump and saying, all right, and says, yeah, I think you're going to make this one, no problem, you got this one, you know, just like, hey, you know, it's all good, it's a beautiful day, hey, do you like my resort, do you like my golf course, isn't it wonderful, isn't it beautiful, I mean, it's just like, it's like one of the most beautiful places in the world, isn't it great to be here, you know, and I mean, wow, like, it's very different, right, very different. And he said, okay, go ahead and knock it in. I got $10 billion. What do I care? You know, be happy. You know, I'm happy. It's that kind of thing, you see. But the mortician in chief is saying, 4-footer, you know, I'm freezing you. Amazing revelation of the character of the leader of the left, which is to freeze us all. Turn us into icicles. And most of us feel like that. And suddenly there's this warm tropical air mass comes in and says, holy cow, maybe, you mean we're not, you know, wow, I feel like I'm thawing out a little bit here. But again, when those two air masses hit, poof, and this is what I saw in the sky, I thought everything's okay, the desert's still clear, the storm's over there, the storm in the Middle East. But suddenly, the clouds started forming in the sky very fast and heavy, and I had spiritual intuition told me, hey, some voice told me, hey, there's a severe storm coming right here, you better, you know, take refuge. And I started looking very fast for this. And then it started raining very quickly, and then it became, you know, super intense. So the people who have not been frozen right now, there's a whole bunch of people say, hey, we're still, you know, not frozen yet. And the other side saying, well, we're going to have to flash freeze you then. You know, flash freeze is coming. And so when that flash freeze hits the warm air mass, you know, whoo, thunderstorm, lightning and thunder, Sturm und Drang, you know, the Germans put it, lightning and thunder. here it comes, ideologically, you see, it's an ideological, the weather, there's an inner weather, this ideological weather of this, and this is what really clobbers us. So I'm not going to jump into to more emphasis because I want this to stand on its own. I've given previous talks on so much emphasis on various areas of the whole situation. Let's just put it this way. Taking refuge is a serious situation. You want to take refuge with that which truly protects you. And you don't want to get with some tour host or hostess who says, you know, well, hey, it's a great time to see how wonderful the world is. And, you know, that kind of, no. Don't fall for that. You know, don't fall for this. Hey, I'll show you a good time. You know, there's a lot of that in the world right now. There's a lot of opportunists out there right now, to tell you the truth. Massive amount of them. Well, we can talk about this. Why not? We got a little time here. Who realize the strain and the stress everybody's going to be under, and then they say, hey, we can really take advantage of this and make a lot of money, and you know, it's like, hey, I'll show you a really good time, but then you become, you know, addicted to it, and before you know it, they end up with all your property, your money, your property, everything. And you don't want it to be that way, because, you know, then they dump you in the gutter, and you don't really have refuge. You don't really have refuge. There's a vast number, for example, of women in the world who are willing to be prostitutes, actually. They've prepared for it. I can see this very, very clear-cut and blatant. They're willing to use their form in a very aggressive way. And their attitude is the willingness to doll themselves up and present themselves like prostitutes. And they realize that this is going to be a huge opportunity to plunder. They're like pirates, actually. You gotta be aware, you know, the men on pirate ships are not the only pirates there are. The women can be very piratical also, and I can, it's just like so obvious, it's so blatant, and we're going to like have a laugh about it later on. Are you kidding me? This like, hey, you know, they're saying, hey, the way to happiness is to worship form, and here I am. I'm your goddess to worship. As I say, the world's into goddess worship, meaning the women, so many women, not all of them, by any means, of course. You have to have contextual understanding of what I'm saying. We're talking about what is troublesome in the world. What are the troublesome trends? And there is a vast armada of female pirates, prostitute pirates, who are very much prepared for this time to take advantage of the situation and say, hey, your salvation is the worship of form, and here's your beautiful goddess right for you. You know, look at all these clothes I can wear. Look at how I can act. Look how, you know, and there's a ton of women who are very raunchy now, who watch pornography, who are all into all of this stuff. They're very raunchy. What is this thing about this Ashley, what is it, Ashley Morgan, this website, adultery website, that's been hacked and outed? There's somebody, some news anchor from San Diego, California, said there are 91,000 residents of San Diego listed on that website who enrolled in, they're trying to encourage you to commit adultery. This is the website's whole purpose, is sign up and we'll match you up with someone else who wants to commit adultery. This is what it is. You sign up, say, I want to commit adultery, and then they have this data bank, and then they give you matches, someone who, you know, profile, they get profiles, and they think, okay, here's someone else who wants to commit adultery, and then they bring you together so you can commit adultery. That's the whole purpose of this website. And they have, how many, like 30 million something people signed up in San Diego, the city of San Diego, 91,000 people had signed up for this website. Can you believe that? And the problem is a lot of the military personnel, and it leaves them open to blackmail. I mean, this is, you talk about, again, food fight going on. You're talking about now in the hands of, this information is put on the web, the torrent browser web, and has probably been available to all foreign governments around the world, and there's their secret service there. They now have information on probably all sorts of civil servants, military people, people in high places, politicians, etc., to blackmail them. Blackmail them, okay? And I've told you that the world runs on blackmail. A lot of it has to do with blackmail. Absolutely, it does. I told you many, many people are in high places are being blackmailed. And now you can see how it works. You can see this is being outed. This is how it works. You get into a situation, adulterous situation. Someone finds out about it, and they say, great. Okay, we won't say a word, but you're going to do a few favors for us. You know, simple stuff, not a big deal, you know. And so they say, okay, we'll do a few things for you. And later on, they'll say, I just need a little favor over here. And basically, then they end up controlling you like a puppet. They've got the goods on you, you see. So this whole thing now is very significant, what happened. Because there are 31 million people or more who are now subject to blackmail by those who have this information that's spread out throughout the world. It's amazing what's happening, right? Absolutely. So again, this is what the Holy Spirit told us. And the whole thing without the Clinton and the servers and the, I don't know, I don't even know anything about technology. What do I know about technology? Nothing, you know. Right. It's the same old. They're like trying to wiggle off. But that's very significant too. So the Holy Spirit said all this stuff is going to happen. Boom, 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 boom. And it is happening. It is happening. And we cannot get caught up in it. We cannot get caught up in it. Cannot get caught up in it. I just have to. And this is what's important. And you can see how easily it is now to get caught up in all of this. And you start, you know, thinking, oh my gosh, what's going to happen? What should we do? This. And it's so, you know, what we really need to do is take refuge. We really need to take refuge. Just one moment here. it's not going to stop. It's not going to stop. I mean, every day, this is what the Holy Spirit has warned us about. Every day, boom, something, boom, 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 boom. So it's exactly what I shared with the world is going to happen. I say it's going to be like a snowball effect. It's a snowball. It's an avalanche, actually, that's happening. It's this terrible thunderstorm. It's an avalanche, and it's snowballing and picking up momentum. And we're saying, oh, my gosh, we're going to get buried by this avalanche. You know, we're going to get buried. Or to use an analogy of a thunderstorm, we are absolutely going to get absolutely drenched by this thunderstorm. It is, holy cow, where is the refuge from this? Where's the refuge from this? Interesting. Maharaj, the rival Maharaj is arriving on an elephant. Someone hands me this today. Here, this is for you. You got to have this. The Maharaj is arriving on an elephant. Wow. The elephant is considered the great vehicle, you know, which is indomitable. It's like a body which just, you know, nothing can affect it. You know, it's unaffected by the, cannot be intimidated. Cannot be intimidated. Now we're used to Trump now pushing back. Saying, I can't be bothered, but there's the spiritual masters. They're way beyond that, you know. They're just quiet. They don't even say anything, and they just show you nothing's touching me. Nothing's bothering me. I'm completely unaffected. Completely unaffected by everything that's going on in the world. I'm absolutely unaffected. Not only that, but I feel absolutely perfectly this is the right thing to do. I know it's the right thing to do. And so I'm unapologetic, absolutely unapologetic about, you know, was Ramana Maharshi apologetic? Like, oh, sorry, folks, you know, I'm quiet and still. No, not at all. Totally unapologetic about it. Visitors would come. His mom would come, begged him to come back home. His mom finally found him. He left home, nobody knew where he was, until eventually they finally discovered his mom came and begged him, begged him, begged him, begged him to come home, and he didn't say anything. His disposition didn't change at all. He just remained completely calm, peaceful, and she realized it was futile, and she finally said, what the heck, I'll just stay here then. Ramana said that she became a saint, became liberated. So now, you know. But yeah, he didn't change at all. It didn't affect him at all. That his parents are pleading for, you know, his mother. He had his various people come to plead, and finally she came, the last desperate attempt. Come back home. You know, we need you here. Everybody wants you here. Nothing. Where's home? You know, is this world home? This world home? He's saying, what do you mean? I am home. It's you that needs to come home, not me. You see, that's what he's not fooled. He says, no, what do you mean? Come home, come home, come home. I am home. It's you're the one that's wandering in a strange, bizarre dream of death. You're the one that needs to come home. So why don't you stay here? And she did. This is great. So these are the liberators, you see. They know where home is. So they're not deceived. They're not deceived. So all the people say, oh, you got, isn't this a wonderful place? You got to stay here. Come out of the. They're not deceived. They're not bothered. They're like a vast elephant. Very mild in Bay Area, California. Very mild, very mild. It's going to be that way, just like low 80s. It's like autumn. Autumn's coming early this year. But the real weather system we're concerned about is this psychological, mental weather storm, weather storm. There's mental weather in this world. Absolutely there is. And these factions are coming together now, and the cold, frigid one and the hot, warm, expansive, moist one come together. The yin and the yang are coming together, producing lightning, thunder, deluge. And then, of course, after a thunderstorm, often there's a very cold, blustery cold winds freeze you, get frozen. It's like happened to my uncle. He become inarticulate. Here was someone that was supremely articulate, supremely in many ways, especially musically. He was absolutely so beautifully articulate, and he completely lost all his articulateness, completely lost it. He couldn't express anything. People thought he had a complete mental breakdown and was suffering severe mental disturbance and had to be locked up and heavily medicated. This is what they believe. And so you went just one day like this from being supremely articulate to being viewed as inarticulate, and your whole life is completely ruined like this. This is what happened to my uncle. And like I said, you'll never meet a better person in this world, hardly. Hardly. Of course, Ramana would be a better someone to meet. Absolutely. And so he's soaked by a thunderstorm. And then the cold, blustery winds that came behind it, you know. So this mental weather can freeze us up, even the most articulate among us, including myself. Absolutely. I could be absolutely frozen by this, no question about it. That's why I'm praying for help and, you know, assistance, and getting into a mood of acceptance for it, you know, humble mood of humility. Absolutely. This thunderstorm here is ferocious, folks. Don't think you can just shrug it off. Again, it's in the Bible. Jesus said, "Even the elect, it will be so severe that even the elect of God will be, you know, be pulled into it, or in danger of being pulled into it. It's that bad." So, in no way do I feel that I'm somehow immune to it. Absolutely not. And I don't feel anyone should have this attitude. They're immune from it, unless you're, you know, perfect, you know, perfectly liberated. I'm not being very articulate right now. That's okay, but you get what I mean. Unless you're like Ramana Maharshi, you should be worried. You should say, "Wow, you know, I'm going to get clobbered by this situation in the world, and I may very well lose my articulateness." And keep in mind the example of my uncle. Who was supremely articulate in a great many areas, actually, lost it all in a day, hit by a thunderstorm in the desert. You don't expect it, didn't expect it. It's unexpected, of course. Sort of a freak thing that just suddenly brewed quickly and caught him. And he was a desert rat. I mean, you don't expect him to get caught like that. He did. He got caught. So we may think that we're really clever and tricky and smart here in this world, but no, we're not smart and clever enough. The ego is vicious, and it doesn't play fair at all, to say the least. And it's setting a very nasty trap for everyone. So those who think that somehow they're, you know, more clever than anyone else, they're going to get hammered by it, unfortunately. So humility is the ticket. Humility is the ticket. Say, "Yeah, absolutely, I need help." And we'll see what sign of song those sing, you know, later on. And I say, "I don't need to take refuge. What are you, stupid?" Well, again, okay, you know, those are singing the song of death. You know, we'll you know, they can't sing that song forever. So sooner or later, you know, you're going to change your tune. Everyone's going to change their tune. Sooner or later, they're going to change their tune. So take that attitude. You know, I'm going to stay listening to the right tune, and don't worry what everyone says. They're bluster. It's just bluster. They'll change their tune at some point. They have no choice but to change their tune. So don't even worry about it. The Holy Spirit's showing you what's going on. And again, this look out for the pirate, the prostitute pirates, the pirate prostitutes, who, and don't think if you're a woman that you're safe. You're not safe at all, okay, from this. This is very important. You know, things have changed. And, you know, the whole attitude of the younger women, et cetera, is, you know, bisexual, trisexual, try anything. They will go after you, too, if you're a woman. They absolutely will go after you. You know, you'll be in a bar, you get drunk, you're taking drugs, and before you know it, who's hooking you? It's another woman, actually. It's another woman, or transvestite, or transgender, or whatever. You know, whatever it is, there's an angle that's going to hook you. There's an angle that can hook you. You're not safe. I mean, so take refuge. Men, take refuge. Women, take refuge. You are being targeted. You're being targeted. And I guarantee you that these pirate prostitutes, both women and men, actually, there's a lot of men that are that way too, using their body this way, they absolutely will. And they have you in their sights, and they're very prepared. They're very expert. It's frighteningly so, actually. They're slick. They know their business. They know what they're after. They're ruthless. And they will target you, and they'll go after you. So this is very important. You don't have some sort of immunity if you're a woman. You absolutely do not. Yeah, I mean, the Holy Spirit is maybe aware of this. And they think nothing of using their bodies in any way possible to gain power, gain control, to you know, fleece you, to plunder your ship. Absolutely, to plunder your ship, like pirates boarding your ship. No compunction, man or woman, you know, doesn't matter. They go either way, makes no difference to them. No difference at all. They have no shame, no conscience about this at all. And they're not talking about small amounts of people. We're talking about vast, vast, vast horde, okay, and a vast armada of this mindset. I've been observing the cultivation of this mindset, and now I'm starting to see, oh, this is what's going on. And they'll say, hey, I can show you a good time. You don't need to take refuge with a spiritual, you know, spiritual refuge. You know, I'll give you. I'm the goddess. I'm the god, the goddess. You know, I'm. You can have fun. You're going to be happy. I'll show you a great time, and before you know it, you're on the floor, and your ship is sunk. Very mischievous. Very determined what they do. They come after you like criminals, like a lioness coming after a prey, you know, or a lion or lioness, or a leopard stalking their prey, and then they suddenly pounce. I mean, they are absolutely going after you the way pirates go after a ship full of, you know, doubloons. You know, pirates finally see that ship. What do? They're determined to get it. So, this is not a joke. I'm sounding the alarm. I'm just realizing, wow, the Holy Spirit's been showing me all this stuff. Hold on. I hadn't quite clicked in, but now it is clicking in very clearly. I didn't see that women are absolutely in danger just as much as men from this. They don't draw any distinction. They're after your ruination, plain and simple, whoever you are. And after their own aggrandizement, you know, absolutely. They think this is the time now. This is the time. They'll leap into the fray. And once you get into this food fight mood and soaked by the thunderstorm, and you'll be like very confused, you lost your spiritual orientation. They see easy prey, just like predators look for someone who's lame or limping or something. That's the one they go after. Predators are very clever in the savannah, like Africa. They'll be They're looking for the one that can't run fast, that somehow is compromised, sick in some way. Then they say, okay, that's the one, that's easy prey, that's the one I'm going to go after. And this predatoriness now, you can feel it, is in people in this world, very predatory. And they're going to look and see, you know, where's your vulnerability? And go after it. And they'll use their bodies like weapons. Absolutely, they'll use their body like weapons. Shameless. More shameless than at any time in the history of this world, you might say. They're more sophisticated and skilled. They've been drilling themselves on these movies and television programs and pornography and everything that's available to prepare. It's like basic training. They've been in basic training, actually. This world provides basic training and all sorts of stuff, like military training, boot camp. They've been in, you know, like a boot camp training to equip themselves with the characteristics they need to seize, you know, what they can seize to be happy, to freeze their own spiritual articulateness, which they think is salvation, you know, which they will please the ego. So they're trying to please the ego and do what the ego is telling them to do. Now, of course, people also say, "We're crazy." I say, "Well, you know, no, we're not, and we'll just see how long it is until you change your tune." Because you absolutely will change your tune. There's no question about it. For example, of course, we know in communistic revolutions, they play dirty, and like the Soviets used a massive amount of hookers to seduce their enemies, people wanted to get rid of, and then blackmail them, adultery, etc. This was the program. I mean, they had it. You know, there were training centers where these women would go in the Soviet Union. They would they would draft them, conscript them. They'd sign up. They say, "Hey, we think that you'd be good at this," and they did these trainings. They trained them to be prostitutes. This was a widespread program in the Soviet Union. But not only that, but they're secret agents, secret agent prostitutes with a lot of other skills, and then they would send them to those people they wanted to eliminate or control, and seduce them and blackmail them. They did this send them into foreign countries, send them to opponents in the Soviet Union. This is just another branch of their military. It's a branch of their military, very important one actually. So these are the tactics that the left has used throughout history, and they will certainly use them again. Looks like I'm really getting the pressure here, aren't I? Yeah, the world's always saying, "Hey, you got to make yourself vulnerable to us, so you can attack you, and practice attacking God. That's what you're here for, right? To help us attack God, right?" No, wrong. We're here to help liberate you from this futile exercise, and you will change. You know, everyone will change their tune eventually. So we're just certain in that fact. So look out, folks, look out. Be aware, be articulate. You know, you're gonna get in serious situations. very likely. And just remember what's being said here. Now, you may forget some, but the vibration is still there, and say, hey, yeah, I remember this is what's going on. Okay, let me start moving towards refuge here. This is the right thing to do. And some of you will do it. This is what I saw in the dream. Some of you will do it. Will take refuge, no question about it. All right. So, the intensity is not going to stop now. So, we better start thinking, take refuge. And stuff is going on that is pretty extraordinary. Very extraordinary. Very extraordinary. Here comes the Maharaj. Welcome, Maharaj. Namaste, Maharaj. Thank you. Thank all that are coming. You know, the spirit, eternal life is coming to our rescue. Let's put it that way. Eternal life is coming to our rescue, knowing that we are eternal life too. And it loves to sing the song of eternal life to us. And it's longing to do so. So let's invite it. Let's invite it in. Eternal life, come on down. We're so pleased that you're here. And we are eager to take refuge in the blessing that you have for us. Very great. That's it for this video.